All right, now you can all see. All right, this is about God changing Abram and Sarai's names. It's from the book of Genesis. Abram and Sarai lived in the country of Haran. They had everything they could ever want. They had a comfortable home, plenty of food on the table, and servants to help take care of their home and animals. But year after year, Sarai waited and waited for a baby of her own. She could not have a baby. One day, God came to Abram and said, "Leave your family and friends and go to a place I will show you. I will bless you with a large family, and you will always be remembered." So this is Abraham hearing from God, and you can see the pictures of all of his descendants in his imagination, also on his beard. Did you know that your imagination was on your beard?
No.
I didn't know that.
I didn't
know that. All right, see here, look. He's traveling right here at the bottom. Abram didn't hesitate. Abram and Sarai believed God. They gathered all their things, their animals, their tents, and their servants. They asked their nephew Lot to come along with them. They said goodbye to everyone they knew. Together, they set out for the unknown, knowing that God had a great plan for them. After they traveled for some time, they came to the land of Canaan, and the Lord appeared to Abram and said, this is the land, and I will give you a future for your family. Abram was so happy that he built God an altar. Abraham praised God because Canaan was so beautiful. Can you say so beautiful?
So beautiful.
So beautiful. God was pleased with Abram. Abram was faithful and trusting, so God gave Abram a new name. Say new name.
Okay.
Your name is no longer Abram. From now on, you will be called Abraham, meaning the father of many nations. You've heard of Abraham, right?
Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah, he was named after this Abraham.
Wow.
Because this is such an important guy. Sarai will now be called Sarah. You know anybody named Sarah?
Yes.
There you go. She will be the mother of kings. So God gave Abram and Sarai new names, Abraham and Sarah, because they did such an amazing thing, trusted him and moved to a new place away from their friends and family because God asked them to do that so God could do great things with them. Fantastic. Hey, guess what else is fantastic? We thank you for Abraham and Sarah and their example. And for Game Sunday, bless these kids, keep them safe and healthy. We pray in Jesus' name.
Yay!
Requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh.
Spirit. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father, Daddy. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God, and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Amen.
Take Mike's mic. Oh, I'm going to have to walk around up here, Mike, on a leash. Did you know that my mouth is connected to my feet when I preach? And so if I don't walk around, it's going to be a really boring sermon. See, it's just caught. It's caught on the guitar. Okay. All right. While Dante flexes, we're going to pray. So don't look at him flexing. Our eyes are going to be closed. We do not notice the man behind the curtain right now, okay? All right, let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, we are glad to be here. We're glad to center ourselves, to hear your children sing hallelujah to you. We're here, we're glad to hear the scripture that instructs us, Lord, that we are your children. We ask that through the power of your spirit, you would allow me to think and to speak clearly and allow us to be receptive to the words that you have for us this morning. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right. Okay, we'll start with the story. This is a true story. This story happened this week, actually. I'm going to be distracted. I'm sorry. This is good. At least we're all friends here. So this is a sound guy on the fly. I appreciate you, Dante. Give him a hand, ladies and gentlemen. He said, just don't trip, because I'm going to tie myself in a knot. All right. Well, this week I went to go visit one of our friends. Many of you will know our friend. Went to go visit her in the hospital. She's had a number of health concerns over the years, a number of different health issues. And I have a great deal of sympathy for her, because the issues are unrelated, and yet because she carries them all in the same body, they become part of one system, and they get very complex. So she had one health issue about a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago, and then a second one pile up on top of it, and the second one sent her into the hospital. So I went to go visit her there. And we were talking and visiting, and I was sitting next to her, and I was just filled, I still don't have this right, either with sympathy or empathy, you tell me which one. But I just felt for her, man. I was listening to her talk. And I could tell how frustrating and difficult and scary it is to be in this particular season of life that she finds herself, where she doesn't know when the next shoe is gonna fall health-wise. She doesn't know if this is gonna act up or that's gonna act up. If you change this medication, then that happens. If you go this way, then that happens. It's all interrelated. And I felt sympathy for how her life has really become dominated by medical concerns. She said, I was going to call you the other day from my house. But first the visiting nurse stopped by, and then somebody else called, and then the people came, and then I had to talk to the doctor's office. And it was like a whole morning of activities filled with conversation and events that were all focused on the health of her body. With all these interconnected health issues, with all these conversations, with all the trips to the doctor and then a trip to the hospital, it's like this rising tide of dominance, of focus on her physical health. To me, I could see how those issues were starting to crowd out, maybe in her mind, she's such a woman of faith, but crowd out anything else because they become so front and center, because every thought, every conversation, every activity, every step outside the house has to do with her health. It's like there's winds and a storm around her. All of it just related to the problems that she's having in her body. A very difficult season for her. Another story. I was talking to another friend this week, a parent, who is concerned for their child. Well, that doesn't narrow it down at all, because every single parent in this room is concerned for their child, right? Okay. Concerned for their child. But in particular, this parent is talking and saying, gosh, you know, we learn about our children as they grow. We see them grow into people, and we see that they have certain wonderful gifts, and that's great. And we also learn about our children's deficits. We learn where they're going to struggle. And as a parent, it's our job and our privilege and our passion to find that deficit, to discover it and say, okay, I'm going to work with you. And I'm going to get myself educated as much as I can about what this challenge is that you have. And I'm going to talk to your teacher, I'm going to talk to a counselor, I'm going to talk to a scout coach, I'm going to talk to the whoever it is, the other loved ones, loved adults in your life. And I'm going to talk to them and I'm going to help create a situation so that you can thrive. You've got great gifts and talents, but you have deficits too, but I'm doing everything I can as your parent to get as informed as I can as your parent, to go to the other adults in your life as your parent and help you succeed. And I know how that feels when you learn about a concern for your child and you're studying it and you're invested in it. Your conversations start to turn around that topic. Your prayers turn around that topic. Your dreams may be centered around that topic. Your appointments, because you're meeting with teachers or pastors or whoever it is, begin to center around that topic. And again, like a rising tide, like the winds that swirl around, it becomes something that is dominant in your vision. And it clouds out other things. This is the way that life feels sometimes, finally. Last example. So I told you last Sunday, I'm not talking about politics in here, right? That you can be an independent, you can be a Republican, you can be a Democrat at Aldersgate. Everybody is welcome here. I didn't say libertarian, did I? You can be a libertarian. You can the Holy Spirit reminding me. I guess we just got an answer. But talking about this election season and the stress that we are feeling as Americans right now is what I want to talk about. I saw an article in the Washington Post that was from the American Psychological Association, I think, saying that they did a survey that over 50% of American adults are either moderately or very stressed about this political season. I mean, it's always important when we elect a president, it's always important, but this one in particular is stressful because it is just so polarized, so entrenched. It's become so personal. Because people, I think this year, are voting against the other candidate, predominantly. I don't hear a whole lot of people saying, oh, like, not everyone's going to agree, but like with Obama, people, oh, I'm so inspired, he just cast vision and hope, you know, people are voting for him, right? We don't hear people voting for Trump very much or for Hillary very much. We hear people say, I am not going to vote for that person. They are so abhorrent to me. So either I'm staying home or I will begrudgingly cast my vote for this candidate I don't like. And because it has become like that, so divided, we take this personally, and it has gotten involved in our relationships. This happens all the time on social media, for those of you who do that. People are unfriending each other all over the place, dialing people down. I don't want to deal with that person, that, you know, that liberal or that conservative anymore. I don't want to hear from them.
happens in our neighborhoods. I had a neighbor of mine say to me, gosh, you know, there's someone kind of across the street and down a little way who just put up a sign of the candidate, well, Trump, she put a Trump sign. And this woman is not a Trump supporter. And she said, there's a Trump sign right across my street, and I can't believe that evil is so close, she said. This is her neighbor. Her neighbor. And it's starting to divide our personal relationships. Like, are we not all on the same team here as Americans in a free democracy to elect our next president doing something together? But instead, we're like opposed to each other. And so we have this incredibly high level of stress. And there's a 24-hour news cycle, and there's the social media that never ends. And it's like this just rising tide and this swirling wind. We're just getting assaulted from every side about it. And it starts to cloud out our vision for anything else. As I was considering these issues, the health issues, the parenting issues, the political issues, there's an image that came to my mind. For me, a very old image, one that I have had since I was a little kid, reading the Laura Ingalls Wilder books. Anybody read the Little House on the Prairie series? All right, we got some people. Some of you watched it on TV, Michael Landon, amen. Anybody? Okay, right? It's okay, there's a... this is the image that came to mind. There, the Ingalls family lived out of the Great Plains in the United States in the second half of the 1800s. There were settlers out there, and I think they lived in Iowa, Wisconsin, North Dakota, that area. See how I said that? Dakota. Next time you say it, Dakota. With that nice Midwestern O. North Dakota. Lived out there. And you want to talk about different times. You want to talk about different concerns. Like, we're mad because our iPhone won't do the latest update. They were concerned about not living in a sod house that was a dugout from the side of a hill, but instead a wood house. They were concerned about eating enough, okay? Different level of concern. And they lived out there on the Great Plains, and they had some livestock, and in this particular part of the story, it's wintertime. And because it's the Great Plains, these winds sweep the weather systems right across so fast, and a blizzard during the winter can blow up just in the blink of an eye. And they, of course, don't have the 7-day Doppler radar forecast, right? They can look at the sky. That's how they find out. So a blizzard had just gone through, and the little house on the prairie is out there, and they have hunkered down during the blizzard, and it has passed. And Pa says to Ma something that also shows signs of a different age. He says, I want to go into town, about a couple hour walk into town. I want to go into town to get tobacco, and I want to hear the news. And I thought, yeah, neither of those are true anymore. We don't go buy tobacco as much, and we certainly don't want to hear any more news. But he wants to go into town, and Ma says, okay, but I'm a little nervous about the weather for you. You know, the storms that come up fast. He says, I'll stay in town. So he takes off, and little Laura and Mary play in the house, and Ma's doing her thing, and everything's fine. Laura looks out the window. It's cold outside. Looks out the window and sees that the sun has changed color. And she says, Mom, the sun is a different color. It's a funny color. And her mother looks and realizes another blizzard is on its way. And so she says, girls, go get firewood. They bring as much firewood as they can into the house to prepare themselves. They're looking down the road, the way to town, to see if they see their dad. They don't. And the snow starts to fly. So for a little while, they're looking out the window. But then they can't see anything because the snow is so thick and it's getting later in the day. They put a lamp right in the window, so that hopefully he could see that if he were on the road, but they just hope most of all that he has stayed back in town. Mom starts to realize that he's not coming home. He must have stayed in town. And those animals that they keep in the barn still need to be fed. This is Pa's job. So the book describes her tiny little feet going into Pa's big boots and how she wraps up and puts a scarf around her head and around her face because she knows about that wind and that's blowing snow. And she's about to head outside. And Mary and Laura say to her, Mama, we're really worried about you. How are you going to make it to the barn? It's not far, but you can't see it from here. And she said, there is a clothesline that goes from the corner of our house to the barn, and I'm gonna walk and hold that clothesline. And she goes out the door, and the door slams shut, and they can't see her, and they can't hear her. All they can hear
is that whirling, screaming wind from that blizzard. And so I imagine Ma out there holding on to the clothesline, walking through snow that's already accumulating in her husband's big old boots, going to feed those animals, worried about her husband, cheeks getting stung by that snow that's swirling around her, the wind coming from every direction, can't see in front of her. And yet the thing that she is most aware of is her hand on that clothesline. That is the thing that's going to bring her to safety. That is the image for us this morning. To hold on to the thing that can bring us to safety in the middle of the storm. And that thing for us, that clothesline for us, that lifeline for us, is our identity in Christ. We have got a relationship with the creator of the universe, a relationship that supersedes every other kind of identity that we have. Our identity concerning our physical body is a very close one. Our identity concerning parenting is a very close one. Our identity as Americans going through this political process is also very close. But my friends, when it comes down to the core, when it comes down to who we actually are at the very center, all those things become stripped away. And we are just a child of God. That is our primary relationship. That is our core identity. We understand, we talked about it a few weeks ago, we have this relationship with God as a gift that God has given to us, that we just received. We didn't earn it. God said, here is the clothesline. Here it is. I'm giving it to you. You don't have to make it. It's already there. You grab a hold. And we said, yes. We said, thank you, God, for looking at all the garbage and junk that I generate in this life and loving me anyway and forgiving me and giving me a way to know you because of Jesus, not only because of the life that he led, but because when he died, he was raised. He was raised, and that shows us that there is no power on earth that can separate us from God. There is nothing in creation that can separate us from God's love. That is the ultimate part of our identity. That identity in Christ, the identity in God. And so we have that to hold on to. A number of weeks ago with the children, actually on kickoff Sunday, we talked about Jesus calm the storm. Some of you were here for that. Jesus calm the storm. And it was the story of Jesus out in the boat with the waves, and Jesus said, stop! Remember little Lily saying, stop! And calming the storm. That's nice when that happens, my friends. Would anybody like to cry stop on the election? Would anybody like to cry stop on their health concerns? Or on the issues children have. But the reality is the health concerns are going to go on, and the children's issues are probably going to go on, and this election's going to go on for at least 23 more days. Right? Got 3 weeks from Tuesday. And so sometimes we cry out, Jesus calmed the storm, and the storm keeps going anyway. The storm didn't stop for Ma. She was on her way out to the barn. She had to do that for 3 days. Pa did not come home for 3 days. She had to go back and forth across that clothesline, but she held on to it. So yeah, sometimes the storms don't go away right away. But we have this core identity to hold on to. So I want you to be encouraged. Like, really mean it. Like, these next few weeks, I imagine that just the conversation and the craziness of all this election stuff is going to continue to escalate. Or, what do you say when it goes down?
De-escalate.
Well, it's not going to de-escalate. It's just going to sink because it has just gotten really low and really nasty. We have probably not been shocked all the way yet. We probably are more shocked out there. Okay? And it's just going to be, if it's not already for you, discouraging, depressing, upsetting, can we remember that while the wind is going and while the snow is hitting our cheeks, the most keen awareness we have is that clothesline, is that identity in Christ. Can you use that to comfort you? Can you remember
that the kingdom of God does not rise and fall on the health of our physical body, on the success of our children, and on who's elected president in the United States in 2016. Can you remember that your identity as a child of God means that you have been adopted into this family that is a part of all human history, bringing about God's love and God's will to this world? Be encouraged, because your core identity is in Christ. Amen. It's time for our... No, it's not. Today is the third Sunday of the month, and this year we are doing a new thing called Third Sunday Testimony, kind of like a throwback Thursday on Facebook, a TBD. We're doing a TST. It's time for someone to tell a story about something that happened in their life when they knew that God was with them and God encouraged them specifically in that particular moment. We're sharing the stories of faith, just regular people telling regular stories, so that we can know that God is alive and active in the world. So Norma heard Sam's testimony last month and was really inspired and said, I have a story to tell. She came running up to me and she said, I must tell it. So Norma, come on up. You can use this. And I want one or two or ten of you to be inspired by Norma, and I want you to come running up to me after the service and say, I've got a story too that I would like to share next month on the third Sunday of November.
I'm sure there are those of you that will remember where you were one Tuesday morning in September, a number of years ago. I was at work over at Railway Express and Crawford Street. I was the district sales secretary. We were in a sub-basement, but had high windows so we could look out. Occasionally, we could see the sky, the 18-wheelers weren't going by. The windows were packed to block our view. So this day, we could see it was a nice day. The temperature was nice, the skies overhead were blue, but they would soon be darkened over New York and Washington. When we heard about the first plane hitting a building in New York, we stood there and wonder, how could this happen? The planes have such, sophisticated technology. How could a plane hit a building? Well, we pondered that. We then heard a plane hit a second building. This wasn't an accident. We were under attack. But by whom? Who was doing this to us? This part of public show got on. My concern reached a high level when the plane went into the Pentagon. Rear Admiral James Amaral was my father's second cousin. He had an office there. It was 4 days before we found out that Jimmy was okay. He had been at the Capitol building addressing the Senate subcommittee on the status of the Atlantic Fleet, but his office had been destroyed. One set of our prayers were answered. Like most, our day continued. We had an ear towards the radio, but we were doing it at a slow pace. It was time to go home. I made my way into the stairwell. We had about 8 steps to go up, and I looked down and said, do I want to go up there? What's waiting for me up there? When I get home, what am I going to find out about the day? Were there other attacks? How many people had been killed? I'm sure many of you had the same thoughts. But then, in front of the door, there was a beautiful little creature. A yellow butterfly flew by and stayed in front of that door. Now remember, we had 18-wheelers running around this building all day. How did this little creature get to the door for me to see? To me, it was God saying, hi, I'm here. I made it, created a beautiful world for you. Go out in it, enjoy it. Remember that I will always be with you, and I will keep you safe by walking with you each day. Two things that I think each day We should kind of try to raise our voice to God with these two thoughts, especially through the violence in our streets today and the chaos in our politics. One, ask God to bless your family, to keep them safe and out of harm's way. Secondly, say, God, bless America.
Thank you.
have an announcement for us.
So TJ and Lauren are getting their black belts, and part of the requirements for getting their black belts, aside from the thousands of dollars we've already spent, to fundraise. And the charity is the Mastocytosis Society. So this Thursday at the Bertucci's in Reading, which I think is across from Walker's Brook Drive. So if you feel like going to Bertucci's on Thursday, so if you hand them this flyer, 15% of your proceeds will be donated to the Mastocytosis Society. And it's all day. It's from 11 a.m. to 10 p.m. So if you go breakfast and lunch. These will be in the back, and even if you forget the flyer, if you end up going, if you just mention the Mastocytosis Society, they said they do. Thank you.
All right, let's go to the Bertucci's on Thursday. I like it. Thank you, Rob. Another announcement, we're all invited to come this afternoon starting 3:30-ish for Pastor Johnson's ordination celebration. Many of us know and love Pastor Johnson, so this is going to be an event that goes for hours, apparently. They have a whole goat, except cut up into pieces, in our kitchen. They are going to be barbecuing. I've never had goat, my friends. I'm coming just for that. I was like, you kidding me, goat? Okay.
Are you kidding?
Stay for a whole long afternoon, but you can also do that as well. Pastor Johnson this afternoon. Also, one other fundraiser, the North Reading Community Corral is selling coffee cakes. Many of you order year after year these coffee cakes that come in right before Thanksgiving. If you want to have some really, really delicious bad calories, go. The sign-up sheet's on the window when you first come in the front door. We can take orders this week or next week, but we like to support them because they support us in so many ways. So think about that. They freeze very well and make good hostess gifts.
How much are they? These?
They're like $95 each. They're so expensive. They're like, just being honest, because most of it goes back to them. I think they're like $12, $13, $14, depending on which ones you get, and they have candy and things. So, consider it a good deal and go get something yummy. And go to Bertucci's. We are going to roll our way into the new year. All right. Celebration and thanks. I have to just thank so much. There's especially a core of people who worked so hard for the Taste of North Reading event last night. We were working, some of us, for a couple months, but especially in the last couple weeks, and especially yesterday. I am not going to name names. I'm sending personal thank you notes. I don't want to forget anybody up here. But you know who you are if you worked hard. I appreciate you. That event, I just saw the numbers from Bob this morning, brought in over $4,400 last night. So part of that will go to the food pantry, the door sales, at least hopefully about $2,000. After expenses, the rest will come to us from the auction. So thank you for coming. Thank you for supporting it with your work, with your attendance, with your donations. I'm just so proud of that event and so thankful to St. Teresa's for offering us this. So, with that being said, please rise for the benediction. May our God, who has given us a new name, Christian, may our God, who is our lifeline through the storm of life, may our God, who has a most majestic name, be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ha ha ha.